First, before I start anything, I would like to thank you for inviting me to the party and for the awesome organization that you put together, you and all the KHL team. Really, thank you very much, guys. That's really, really good. I did plan about half a dozen of jokes about my French accent. I'm the fourth French-speaking speaker, so they're all unrelevant. So I'm going to start straight away by introducing myself. I'm Jean-Charles Delplace. My role is a business developer for the Trimble Lifting Solutions division. So it's the division of Trimble, which aims to develop the different solutions for the crane business. What I'm going to do to start with is to introduce you with Trimble. Some of you know Trimble from other divisions, from other business that we're involved in. Most of you don't know Trimble because we're not very present in the crane business yet. So I'm going to share a video with you to present what Trimble come from and basically what we're doing. To Trimble, we are 7,500, 8,000 worldwide in 100 and something countries. We are 3.5 billion quoted at the Nasdaq, so we are a large organization. As you've been able to see on the video, we are present in lots of different sectors, and the construction sector is a very important sector for us. The crane industry has been always a gap in Trimble portfolio, and our job is to try to fill that gap with some really new and innovative solutions. You probably know LSI a lot better than Trimble. LSI is one of the key players in the RCI, LMI, load moment indicators, and all the crane instrumentation worldwide. So Trimble has acquired LSI in August 2014, a little under a year ago. And that was to increase our footprint in the crane business. And it was also because LSI has developed a very interesting wireless technology that they own. And most of the products are based on that wireless technology. Some of the products are as well wired. And they develop a range of products that are very interesting for us in the future. And we hope for you right now. So please come on the booth during the break. You'll be able to see a couple of the products that LSI has developed in the last couple of years, and there's some really good solution for the tower crane business. So I'm here based on a couple of discussions that we've had with Alex, and the idea for the pitch is really to discuss what is the future in terms of connectivity for the cranes? And for us, there's a concept that Trimble is really attached to, which is the connected site. So you may want to ask, what is the connected site? The connected site started about 10 years ago in the earth-moving part of our business. And basically, the concept of a connected site was to connect all the different players on a construction site with the same data. So about 10, 15 years ago, we developed we were the first to develop the GNSS, what we call GNSS, the GPS for the bulldozer. And based on these developments, we are able to do some machine control on the dozers, on graders, and so on, for the off-moving. And these features needed to have data to be able to run the equipment. So that's how we started the connected site. It's you can see a desktop on the top right, where there is solutions to be able to, based on the data coming from the surveyor, we're able to pull the data and work the data out to be able to feed the machine control and control all the different equipment in the off-moving that are working based on what has been designed in 3D. So that's something that we started about 15 years ago, and it grew very much, and now we've got lots of different applications, so I'm not going to detail everything because it would take hours, but it's coming from drones that takes picture of a landscape, right all the way down to all the analytics to be able to know what the machine was doing and how well the site performed, all the way through CAD application software, lots of different software to be able to work out both the off-moving and the building construction. So what we are more interested with is really the building side. You can see a crane in the corner there. On the building construction inside Trimble, it's roughly about 20, 25 different solution or company. So we are very wide portfolio in that domain, and in there you've got most of software solutions that are used to be able to work on the BIM. So the BIM is a big word. Most of you have heard about it, especially in the UK. I'm going to go through that in a minute. Some of you don't know at all what is the BIM. The BIM is a concept about putting data together and design a building in 3D. And more than the building, you're not only designing the building, but you also bring lots of information in all the data that you put together. And information about the timing, how to make the building, about the cost as well, the different resources involved, the project schedule, and so on. So I've got a video there that I can share with you, which is a project that has been completed on different software that we've got. And basically what you've got there, it's for those who are not familiar with the 3D, it's a 3D model on which there is all the different details of what is needed to make the building. So you got the structural steel structure, you got the concrete, and it goes really to the detail. That's something on which Trimble has some unique solutions to really go down to what we call the constructible model, on which you can see absolutely everything, the piping, the vents, the air conditioning, and it goes down to the bolt in terms of details of the model. So on that, there's absolutely everything that will be put together to make the building. So that's an example of a BIM model, and that what you're seeing there is the 3D. Next to that, there is what we call the 4D and the 5D, fourth and fifth dimension. The 4D is about the time. It's how the building will be made over the time of its construction. And we've got solution as well in what we call the 5D, which is actually the cost associated. So a solution like Vico, for example, on which you can schedule the way the building is going to be made and know the cost associated for the early stage for the costing. So all these solutions work together through something that's very important for us. It's called Trimble Connect. It's our hub. It's a platform on which all the different solutions can exchange data And what you're seeing there has been done with two, potentially three different solutions that works together, three different solutions, actually. So that's important for us. In the BIM concept, the 3D is important, but there's not only the 3D, there's some information as well. And that comes from lots of different software that tie together through a platform, which is Trimble Connect for us. And one of the software that is part of our portfolio is SketchUp. So what you're seeing there actually is the way the building looked at the early stage of the project when the architect was involved, and some of them are using SketchUp as a tool to be able to have a first rendering of the model and share that with the customer. Sometimes I get the question: it's how much is BIM implemented in the real world? You know, it's awesome. There's lots of 3D, lots of very interesting thing, and it looks awesome. But how much is it implemented? And that's a very, very good question to ask right now, because almost all the general contractors are starting to very much use the BIM approach and to implement the BIM approach. One of the reasons why they do that now is that in the EU in 2014, there's a new procurement directive that has been voted, which says that all the public-related bidding will need, at some stage, to be associated to a BIM model. So some of you are very familiar with what I'm saying, especially in the UK, because the UK has voted that it would be mandatory to have a BIM model for the public bidding in 1st of January 2016. So it's going to be in 6 months about from now. I know some of you are very aware about that because you're living this on a day-to-day basis. And for the public bidding, there will be a BIM model associated to it. So it means that it's very much real for all the general contractors in the UK. You can't really see on the picture, but it was the case for the northern part of Europe already a couple of years ago. It's going to be mandatory in 2017 in France, and Germany is going to give a date in the next couple of weeks. So what it means that most of the general contractors, if not all, are really implemented what you saw just before, the 3D, and they're working in a BIM approach of putting everything together in the virtual world before going on site. That's a couple of figures. It's a survey that's been done in 2013. And it shows it was showing the implementation of BIM at the time, and there was roughly about 30% worldwide of the large general contractor that was that implemented the BIM. And in 2013, the projection was roughly about 65-70% worldwide of implementation. It's very difficult to get figures together. I've tried to bring something factual to you today, guys, because it's difficult to get figures because it's growing extremely fast. So the general contractor right now, they are implementing it, most of them. So most of you could say, okay, that's great. Okay, that's a nice picture. You're putting 3D together. That's lots of information, lots of data. Basically, our customer, the general contractor, they're using that. But okay, at the end of the day, what's the impact for us? We are renting cranes. We are making cranes. That's great. But why would it change our day-to-day business? And if you think that, somehow, you're very right. It doesn't change anything. It makes your customer's life easier. They work in 3D. They can find out problem before it happens in real life and so on. So it wouldn't change nothing to your day-to-day life. But the thing is that the revolution that happened 20 years ago in the car industry or 30 years ago in the aircraft industry is happening now in the construction. And these guys, all the general contractors, they now start to rethink the way they make building. And then it starts to have an impact on your business. And there's some company worldwide that are thinking about that. I spoke roughly to about 10 general contractors of the top 25 in the last 2-3 years. Every single one of them are thinking, how can I optimize the way I make buildings? How can I shrink the construction time? How can I be on site for lower time, for less time, and how can I be more efficient? How can I use my crane in a more efficient way? And then when they think like that, that impacts your business. I would like to share with you a video, and for that I would like to thank first Lengo Rourke, Most of you, all the English attendees know very well LangoHawk. From all the companies I met with in the US, in Europe, in Asia, LangoHawk is one of the large general contractors, which is the most advanced in that way to think. They're using, they've got an internal project which is called DFMA, Design for Manufacture and Assembly. And they are thinking, they are rethinking completely the way they make buildings. So I'm going to share a quick video with you. It's just the beginning of a 10-minute video. I couldn't share the entire video with you, but you can find the video online on YouTube, and you can go through the 10 minutes. The beginning of it is going to explain their approach and how they see the world, basically.
The world is changing. The way we live, work and play is being transformed by technology. In business, this is creating a new challenge as clients now expect better and faster delivery. Though in the current economic climate, often they have less money to spend. Never have things been more competitive. Innovation is key to staying ahead of the game. Today, even the simplest things are designed and tested virtually before being manufactured ready for use. Heavy industries like automotive and aerospace have pioneered these smarter processes using components manufactured remotely and then brought together for final assembly. All this saves time and money, reduces risk, and increases quality. So why does our industry still create the built environment in the same way as it always has? Using techniques that are unpredictable, unsafe, unskilled, and overlong. In ways that are all too often unprofitable and unreliable. Why can't construction embrace and benefit from technological progress too? At Lang O'Rourke, we're doing precisely that. We've invested 25 years of knowledge and expertise into creating a better way, one that puts us at the leading edge. We call this unique approach design for manufacture and assembly. And it means we can now build things more quickly, more safely, more sustainably, more cost-effectively, to a higher quality and with greater predictability in both cost and program. To make DFMA work, many things have to come together seamlessly. We've gathered together the people, technologies and processes we need to create a unique integrated delivery capability.
So based on that approach, what these guys are saying, they're saying the automotive industry is very industrial, actually the crane industry as well. When you make cranes, you design the crane and you manufacture the crane after in a very industrial way. And these guys are saying, why not the construction world? We're different, but how much different, you know? How much can we leverage from the industry, the mechanical industry, to put that in the construction business? And based on that, they've got, I talk under their control, and stop me if I say something wrong, but got 7 factories in the UK that pre-assemble, pre-manufacture parts that are put together after on-site. And based on that, they are reducing the time spent on-site, and what happens on-site is really organized. They know exactly what is going where, when, how, and so on. So these guys are really industrializing the construction, the way to make buildings, basically. So that starts to have an impact on, a pretty significant impact on the crane. Out of 10, I don't know all the world, you know, at all. Out of 10 general contractors that I met, every single one of them are thinking in that direction. There are different levels. Some are not advanced, not very advanced. Some are very advanced. LangoHawk is one of the most advanced in that way to think. But every single one of them is using the 3D opportunity to change the way they make buildings. Another example, which is very extreme, it's a Chinese company. The Chinese delegation probably knows them very well. It's a company called BSB, Broad Sustainable Building. They started their business about a long time ago, I think, but I know that concept is a 5-year-old concept, something like that. They completely rethink absolutely everything in terms of construction and how to make the buildings. And these guys were only 6 million to have seen the video online, so you probably saw it. But let's look at it again. So one more time, this is very extreme. I mean, all the general contractors are not doing this kind of thing. But the trend is there. Thanks to the 3D, this kind of thing was very possible before. You could have drawings, you could have 2D, you could have done that, but it was a lot more complicated. Thanks to the 3D, the BIM, all the tools that we're bringing together, now this kind of approach is much more easier-ish to put together. So that's, one more time, that's very extreme. That's to show the trend, and the trend for all the general contractor is to think, what can we do to work differently and have a different approach on making buildings? So back to the original question, what is the future of Crane within the connected site? Of course, in terms of connectivity, this kind of vision of how the site and how the construction is evolving brings lots of different features that we will have to do somehow, or we think we'll have to do in the Crane connectivity for the future. So I just took four bullet points to cover that part. And the first one, safety first, always. So in terms of safety, shrinking the construction time means having more cranes working together on the same construction site, which means that the anti-collision on this kind of project is absolutely a must. So you can see a little bit on the background the picture with the cranes on the Chinese site. At the peak, there was 8 cranes working together, and the building is 33 meters long. So it's roughly a site of 50, 60 meters by 30 meters, and there's 8 cranes working together. You see how close they are. That, without any safety behind that, is just completely impossible in Western countries. So, having that said, the general contractor wants to shrink the time again, so that means more cranes working in close proximity, and that's going to be more and more common for the site that the general contractor will come with. So the anti-collision, PLD, those who are familiar with the anti-collision subject and the safety subject in general know very well what I mean. Being an operator help is not enough, it will have to be a safety system. The other key feature in terms of connectivity is the synchronization of the site. Having 8 cranes working together with such a very tight schedule. Again, it's extreme, but if we talk about Lengo or other general contractor, they are trying to control their schedule and make sure that what is supposed to happen happens. And that means that every single person on the site needs to know what it's doing, the crane, the riggers, all the logistics, the trucks and so on. They need to be to deliver on time and to deliver what they're supposed to deliver. So that means that everyone needs to be really tied to the same schedule. And in terms of connectivity, we think there's going to be more planning tools to know what the crane will be doing and how they're going to interact to prepare how the site will be managed. And all these tools will have to work together. The schedule has to be shared by all the people on site. They all need to know what they're doing and what they're going to do next. Logistic as well. If something goes wrong, they will have to know what goes wrong and to be informed as soon as possible. So in terms of connectivity, we see a lot of feature in terms of planning, schedule, logistic to work together. The reliability. So that's something that you guys, you are the tower crane business, that's what you deal with every day. Getting to have cranes that are more reliable is just what you focus on every day. And shrinking the construction times means that the crane will be on site for less time, and therefore it's going to be even more critical to have reliable crane. So that's something that I heard a lot from the general contractor. Because they want to shrink the time, the crane breakdown is just something that they don't want to hear about. So it is difficult to deal with the reliability, and it's you know that 100 times better than I, that the reliability is critical. It's going to get even more critical. So in terms of connectivity, what we see is that the monitoring of what the cranes are doing, so all the what you're developing about the asset management, the tracking, the remote diagnostic, and so on, that's going to be even more and more critical to know exactly what the crane is used for, and to be able to manage the preventive maintenance. That's going to become, it is a subject for you today, it's going to be even more and more of a subject in the future. And finally, the last bullet points that I've put on the slide is about the weather. So we're going to say there ain't much we can do about the weather, but again, construction time shrinking, having more cranes on site, means that the weather, especially the wind impact, is going to be more and more critical. So trying to control the wind as much as possible, but by knowing the site effect before being on site, knowing where the wind will blow, how the crane could be impacted in its lifting, and anticipate the wind effect, it's something that will probably be part of a solution in the future. And getting to get forecast integrated in the logistic and what the crane are doing is something that we think is going to be even more critical in the future. That's it. Thank you very much for your attention. And thank you.